This is a talk on hand transplantation that I gave for a UK hand diploma revision course. And the first question I ask is, what are the indications for hand transplantation? And in my mind, the indications are a blind patient who's in renal failure, who's imminently about to start dialysis and therefore have immunosuppression if he has a transplantation, who's already got traumatic hand loss as an adult. Now, obviously, these indications can be stretched, but adults are less able to cope with tissue loss and hand loss than a child who adapts. A blind patient won't be able to cope so well using prosthetics without sensory feedback. And obviously the patient in renal failure will, at some stage, be having immunosuppressants and using immunosuppressants in order to improve the quality of life with a hand transplant rather than the length of life as one would have with solid organ transplantation is a big ethical dilemma. So generally when we look at the upper limb, amputation by cause, it's very different from the lower limb where the high scorers are the peripheral vascular disease and diabetes. In the upper limb it's predominantly trauma and congenital loss, and there are infective losses as well from meningitis. So if one has a mangling hand injury, what's the optimum reconstruction, a hand transplantation or a modern prosthetic? So let's look at the history of transplantation. So the first skin transplants were done in the 1860s, a corneal transplantation in 1906. But the first solid organ transplant was between two identical twins in 1954, heart valves 1955, cadaveric renal transplantation 62, liver transplant 63, and so it goes on. But the biggest changes and the biggest stride forwards was after the discovery of cyclosporin. That was in 1983. Once that was introduced, that really made a difference to survival of solid organ transplants, and it made it almost a mainstream surgical reconstructive technique. So the difference between solid organ transplantation and composite tissue allo transplantation are that in a solid organ transplant, one's correcting physiology, and you can measure those results immediately. You can prolong life, and you can use those physiological parameters or a biopsy to monitor how your transplant is doing. In a composite tissue allogeneic transplantation, such as for the face or the hands, they're really for improving cosmesis and function. But there's a potential to shorten the life of a physiologically intact individual through immunosuppressant therapy or complications from surgery. And there are pretty much delayed results from surgery because even in the face or the hand, the nerve needs to reinnervate into those muscles. Rejection, however, can be visible, and simple skin biopsies can be taken and topical immunomodulators can be used. So that's a significant benefit over solid organ transplantation. So when was the first one performed? Well, it was actually in Ecuador, and it was done in 1964, but without immunosuppression, and it only lasted for about 2 weeks. In the late 1990s, there was an International Federation for Society of Surgery of the Hand-sponsored composite tissue allo transplantation symposium. And then the same year, a unilateral hand transplant was undertaken in Lyon, in France. Another one was undertaken the following year by Breidenbach in Kentucky, USA. Following that, China did hand transplantation. Bilateral hand transplants were undertaken in 2000. And so it grew and started to spread around the world. In 2000, there was an identical twin arm transplant by Pathmanathan in Seliang Hospital in Malaysia. This was a child with phocomelia and a twin with anencephaly. And the anencephalic child had their limb transplanted onto the child with phocomelia. And so because of the identical genetics, there was no need for immunosuppression. A double hand transplant was performed in China in 2000, and then Italy, Belgium, Germany all set up transplant programs. One of the biggest centres for hand transplantation in the USA is with Lee in Pittsburgh. They've developed the protocol, and this is using an inoculum of donor bone marrow and tacrolimus to to try and reduce the sensitization of the recipient so that they tolerate the transplant better, and the patients can then be managed on single lower dose immunosuppression therapy. There were other treatments that have been undertaken in this history of transplantation, so hand and face together. First double hand transplant in the States was in 2009, followed by the second in 2010. Australia undertook hand transplantation in 2011, Mexico 2012, and UK in 2013 with Professor Simon Kay. So clearly there's been a big uptake in hand transplantation around the world, and there are some questions that are raised, some ethical considerations that one needs to consider. So there are issues obviously regarding the donor and the recipient. So one of the things that we have to think about is, where do these transplants come from? And China was criticized for using prisoners who'd died and using their tissues and organs for transplantation. There is some evidence that actually visible organs or tissues such as corneas, hands and face may actually serve to reduce the willingness of donors to join transplants registries on opt-in systems. And that's an important consideration, so that we don't reduce the available pool of potential donors and potential organs. For the recipient, one has to think about the capacity. They do have the right to decide what happens to their body. There's the benefit of sensory and motor recovery potential, but one has to balance the effects of harm versus gain. There are some important issues that need to be ironed out about recognition of self and patient identity. Identity is an important concept, so the psychological concept of self. The hand is visible, the hand is integral to our self-identity. It's our way of interacting with others and with our environment. And although there is a significant risk of physiological rejection, there's also the psychological rejection in composite tissue allogeneic transplantation as opposed to solid organ transplantation. And then on a practical note, there's the importance of thinking about the size, gender, and colour match. One has to think about beneficence and non-maleficence when thinking about ethical considerations in surgery. So beneficence is the action that's done to benefit the patient. So hand transplantations can improve your quality of life, your function, your self-image, your ability to return to work. But the degree to which you use your hand is very dependent on the patient. And non-maleficence is one does not intentionally harm patients either through acts of omission or commission. It's difficult to demonstrate that the benefits of hand transplantation outweigh the risk, particularly with the advances that are occurring at the moment in upper limb prosthetics. And patients will survive without the operation, and performing the operation and using lifelong immunosuppressants does carry a risk of mortality for the patient. So what do you need to know for the UK Hand Diploma? Well, you need to know how you would set up a transplantation service, the ethical approval, the need for transplantation immunology on site with clinical screening systems, a good limb fitting service, looking at alternative strategies, physiotherapy, hand therapy, psychological services, as well as the surgical services that are required. And the surgical technique is actually relatively straightforward. It's a macro replantation, but the distal vessels aren't traumatized. Three teams usually involved, one for retrieval, one for working on the residuum, and one for working on the allograft. And typically, like for any macro replantation, it would be bones and vessels, followed by tendons, nerves, and skin in time sequence. Simon Kay has reported on synchronous amputation, so amputation of a non-functioning hand at the same time as reattaching the transplanted limb. And the benefit there, of course, is that you can accurately map the neural topography when you also reduce the risk of the exponential decay in the proximal nerve stump that occurs through apoptosis after a long delay following amputation. So the UK first hand transplant was done in 2013. There is NICE guidance on hand transplant surgery. In 2011 this was released, and there is an international registry for hand and composite tissue transplantation. One other thing I think is worth knowing about for the purposes of the exam is that the preoperative pooled human immunoglobulin and donor bone marrow transfusions with tacrolimus monotherapy seems to be the least harmful of the regimens for immunosuppression. And questions need to be asked though about the utility of hand transplantation and whether actually these risks can be outweighed by the benefits. And certainly this is an important area to look at, but this provisional early article on this topic hasn't demonstrated very great benefits to patients from composite tissue transplantation. So a couple of other things to consider, things that we've done in a recent survey. What about donor acceptability? Are the public aware of hand transplantation, and would the potential for them being used as a composite tissue donor deter them from donation? And what mortality risk would a patient be willing to accept in return for hand function? Well, in answer to those questions, the patients generally aren't aware that hand and face transplantation can be undertaken. And they do feel, on the whole, that they would be less willing to act as a donor. But when we're asking normal populations, they would say that 4.5 years shortening of their life was the mean duration that they were willing to accept in terms of having a successful functional hand transplant. But they would be more willing to accept a greater risk with bilateral loss. So the things I've thought about for the purpose of the diploma, think about the indications and contraindications and the alternatives, such as prosthetics. Understand the difference between solid organ and composite tissue transplantation. Think about how you would set up a service, the surgical technique you would employ for a macro replant. Understand immunomodulation and monotherapy, and the fact that rejection can be monitored and treated with topical agents, and the degree of rejection can be assessed often with biopsies of the skin. There is an international registry. Understand ethical principles of hand transplantation, and the UK NICE has reported in 2011. I hope that's of some benefit.